this video, we're going to take a closer look at transcutaneous pacing. Now, we're going to use this for bradycardic patients where atropine was ineffective. Where does this happen? A lot of blocks, right? Lower blocks. So we can use atropine on a sinus bradycardia, sinus with a first degree heart block, even sinus with a second degree heart block type 1 Winky block, atropine might be effective. Once the block gets below that, atropine is most likely not going to be effective. So your second degree type 2 heart blocks and your third degree heart blocks, you want to get out your pacer quickly. First, pad placement for transcutaneous pacing. You can go front to back, that's fine. Most of the patients I've paced, I had the pads high right, low left, in the same position I would have them for defibrillation or cardioversion, and it's always worked fine. So get the pads on. Make sure that the wires leading to the pads are not under the pads. Make sure there's no jewelry underneath the pads, gold necklaces, anything like that, medication patches, implanted devices. We want to have a clear path from one pad through the heart to the other pad, unobstructed. Okay, now all cardiac monitors are a little bit different. It's your responsibility to know how your equipment works, but they basically work all the same. After the pads are on, you're going to go to your monitor and you're going to select pacing. So get the monitor in pacing mode. Next, it's probably going to ask you to set a rate. How fast do you want to pace this patient? Follow your local protocols. 80 sounds good to me, so we're going to set our pacer here at 80. Then we're going to slowly start to turn up the milliamps. You'll see the MA on the monitor, and that's the electrical current that we're giving to the patient. So you're going to slowly turn up the milliamps until you see electrical capture on the monitor. Electrical capture is going to be a pacer spike followed by a wide QRS. We have electrical capture. Infinitely more important than that, do we have mechanical capture? Is this pacing generating a pulse? So while you're pacing, feel for a femoral pulse. It's a good pulse to check for because you should be able to feel pulsation coming off the heart, down through the aorta. Remember, when you're checking for a pulse, check for a more central pulse. It's not uncommon when you're pacing the patient that they start to twitch, so it may be hard to detect a pulse on the periphery. A femoral pulse may be a better option. Now, one of our rules to keep in mind for transcutaneous pacing is we want to use the least amount of energy necessary to generate a pulse. So if you've turned those MAs up, you may want to throttle them back a little bit and use the least amount of energy necessary to generate a pulse. Now, transcutaneous pacing hurts. You're electrifying the body to get the heart to beat. It's painful. Be kind. Give them a little Groovacaine. Fentanyl might be a nice option. It doesn't have a lot of hemodynamic effects, but you have to treat the pain. Your protocol may call for a little Versed, a little sedative. Absolutely appropriate. So Versed, fentanyl, whatever's in your protocol, that's fine, but do address the pain and pacing because it hurts. So this has been just a quick review of transcutaneous cardiac pacing. I'm Mark, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.